Memorial Oration Award, Humanism, Human Rights and Mental Health Practice. For this, we have chairpersons,
Dr. Neena Bohra ma'am, who is a very senior psychiatrist, and ma'am is known by all of us. Ma'am knows, needs no introduction. Please, ma'am, come on the stage. And second chairperson, Dr. J.M. Vadhavan, sir. And sir is a senior psychiatrist, renowned psychiatrist, nationally and internationally. Sir is in Gangaram and Pran in private practice. Sir, please have a seat, sir. And today's talk will be delivered by no other than our beloved Dr. Nimish Desai, sir. And this is the first Dr. H.C. Raheja Memorial Oration Award, which is conducted by DPS. And we are happy to share that we all have Dr. Nimish Desai, sir, will be delivering this talk. Dr. Nimish Desai, sir, I request you to come on the dais. Just few lines for our Dr. Harish Chandra Raheja, sir. He was one of the pioneers of private psychiatry establishments, and he established the first private in-care patient psychiatry center in Delhi. He pioneered in innovative methods of humanistic care of treating the persons with mental illness. His legacy is carried forward by his sons, Dr. Deepak Raheja, Dr. Nikhil Raheja, and his daughter, Dr. Jyoti Jagga Raheja. Not taking much of time now, I would give the right mic to our chairpersons and they will take it from there. Neena ma'am, please.
I request people to come in. You can have later dinner, please. Or just snacks can be served in the hall. Dr. Pankaj, snacks yahan serve kara dijiye so that they can come inside. Well, I met Dr. Raheja somewhere in 73, beginning, Senior Raheja. He just walked into my office. I was a specialist at HMD Shahdra, now in Bars. And he just said, yeah, I'm a practitioner. So we had a cup of tea. And then he discussed what are the challenges faced in a private practice in the government service. I'm happy. Good. Hello, Vikas. Anyway, the topic chosen by Dr. Nimish, first of all, the award has been given to him on Dr. Raheja's memory. And the topic he has chosen is humanism, human right, or the mentally healthy. Pankaj has given. I thought it is your choice because you are devoted with the passion and all that which the humanism really means. Whether you want it or not want it, you want to do something of the human right, mentally health. Let's hear Dr. Nimish Desai. The award has been conferred. Kuch dena nahi hai inko pehle, baad mein denge. Dr. Raheja, inko kuch pehle nahi dena. Baad mein dete hain. Chalo. I'm sorry. Chalo aa jao fir Dr. Nimish.
Okay, that is young Dr. Raheja at his graduation. Babu ji, aapke liye.
Oh, lovely.
Kahan se chale jaoge na? Kis disha mein? That's Dr. Raheja Sahab with a lot of IPS office bearers of that time. Some of you seniors might recognize, some of them I do. And that's Dr. Raheja as we saw him in the last few years before we lost him. But I'm going to I don't know if anyone of you remembers this small snippet from Mera Naam Joker. I have always found this very fascinating and associated that with a few people like Dr. Raheja Sahab. I hope you can hear the dialogue, otherwise I'll possibly do that for you. You can't hear. Essentially what Raj Kapoor and Om Prakash are exchanging is this dialogue about how RK's heart keeps growing big एंड ओम प्रकाश एंड राज कपूर से ओम प्रकाश एज ए डॉक्टर इज ट्राइंग टू से लुक राजू तुम्हारा दिल बहुत बड़ा होता जा रहा है, इतना बड़ा ना हो जाए कि इसमें सारी दुनिया समा जाए. एंड राजू जोकर इज वेरी थ्रिल्ड एट द प्रोस्पेक्ट एंड से डॉक्टर साहब ऐसा हो सकता है कि मेरे दिल में सारी दुनिया समा जाए. I really for me that was the essence of some people like Dr. Ajay Sarna and others that we remember. It so happened that 4 years ago, on the 10th anniversary of having lost Dr. Ajay Sarna, I am sharing this because again the Raja family, Babiji was here, was there, Deepak, Nikhil and other family members. That time we had kind of memorized Dr. Ajay Sarna. To save what were his qualities, and I'm going to come back to that later again. But I've tried putting down here what I think is. Yeah, my laptop yahan de doge please. Kuch to thoda professional karte hai yaar. As a person, he was possibly the most large-hearted person that you could come across. Ever so helpful for everyone, totally family-oriented. मैं जनरली हिंदी से अंग्रेजी में ट्रांसलिटरेशन नहीं करता हूं, लेकिन मैं अपने आप को रोक नहीं पाया यारों के यार. प्रैग्मेटिक, वेरी प्रैग्मेटिक पर्सनली एंड प्रोफेशनली, वेरी इनोवेटिव एज यू विल सी सम ऑफ द थिंग्स, केयरिंग एंड सेंसिटिव. एंड एज आई सॉ, एज आई वाज टोल्ड अ फ्यू डेज अगो, एज आई सॉ एंड दैट्स व्हाई द टाइटल, आई सॉ हिम एज वन ऑफ द ह्यूमनिस्ट एज अ पर्सन एंड एज अ प्रोफेशनल. एंड ऑफ कोर्स एज वाज सेड एंड इट मस्ट बी रिपीटेड एनी नंबर ऑफ टाइम्स, one of the pioneers in Delhi, if not North India, for a lot of things. First, inpatient private sector setting. First, long stay aftercare setting. The first rescue service for my team and now call as homebound mentally ill persons. Those were the qualities. And of course, he was a very, very little known fact. He was honorary treasurer for the National IPS at one point of time. And for some reasons that he didn't go further in that. And of course, as Sandeep Bora and a lot of other people tell me, a very empowering mentor. A lot of young people like Sandeep Bora who wanted to start practice and went and spoke with him, a whole lot of qualities. I won't keep repeating that. Dr. N.K. Bora and Dr. Raijas have shared so much. I genuinely have been thinking in the last 2 days that while the revered Dr. Vidyasagar is the legend in Punjab, I don't see why we don't say enough about how Dr. Aheja was at least very similar for Delhi. A whole lot of things that I already said. I must also say that in this technology glitch, I forgot to thank the GP Council and the office bearers of IDPS for having me do this first Dr. Harichand Raija Memorial Award, Oration Award, because professionally and personally, amongst the few people who have considered as family for a long time, Dr. Raija has been one, and so is the entire family. And so I am thrilled to bits to have thought about this for last few days and to bring some ideas to you, as I think all orations should be, memorial orations, and certainly the first one, for next few generations to understand what the person and the professional was and then come to the science technical part of it. And so please bear with me as I go on bit of personal and professional reflection before we come to the science or the technical part of it. I must say that very few people of this list are with us now. Nina ji is here. I was hoping Malik sahab would be here, but he couldn't. He's at home taking care of his responsibilities. And I say this. So what I'm going to say is the oration with a tremendous respect for a whole lot of people listed here and a few that I might have overlooked. But please bear with me. मेरा लैपटॉप दे दो प्लीज, वहां हो तो प्लीज. एट द सेम टाइम, अ लॉट ऑफ रिगार्ड फॉर माय कंटेम्पररी कॉलीग्स. आई वांट यू टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस, यंगर पीपल. इफ आई गो बैक फॉर अ मिनट, यू हैव दिस जनरेशन ऑफ पीपल, इफ आई एम नॉट मिस्टेकन नीना जी, इंक्लूडिंग यू एंड वदान साहब, द प्री इंडिपेंडेंस, और वदान साहब आई एम नॉट टू श्योर, बट या. So we are talking about a generation of people who were born in the 40s, like Dr. Raija Sahab, you know, and who grew up to be psychiatrists in the 60s and 70s and then carried on to now. Thanks so much, yaar. Thanks so much. So useful, really. And then my immediate senior or contemporary colleagues who I have listed here, who were the post-independence generation, people born in the 50s and 60s, I must say a lot of respect and regard for both these groups. Bear with me for a minute as I get my slides here. And I'm now about to turn to my technical aspect. The title, Humanism to Human Rights, as some of these dear colleagues on the council and the office bearer colleagues of DPS and we were discussing just a few days ago, I do want to say to all of us across generations that global tradition has been, of course, more in Afro-Asian tradition of collectivism, social responsibility and humanitarianism, or humanism as you wish to call it, over time has changed significantly to assertion of human rights. So it's no longer the issue of being nice to somebody because he or she is a fellow human being, for good or bad, and I'm going to talk about that. But as a legal obligation, you better be nice to the other person. You have no business not to be nice and not to assure, give him or her rights. This has happened noticeably in the fields of disability and mental health, but I want you to pause for a minute and think, in almost every area of life, care of older persons, care of children. Allow me this. Mid-80s, I was visiting US-UK for the first time, and I had this classmate of mine from Ahmedabad, who I was staying with for a weekend. And there was this five-year-old kid. When the father was saying something, the five-year-old kid said, "Dad, I don't want to do it, period. Or I'll call 911. And I was really shocked. Really, 35 years ago, I said, is this what parenting is about? But then if you pause and think, not just in disability and mental health and the underprivileged populations, but almost all areas of life, now what's happening is legal assertion of rights. The elder, older person, or the lady in the household or the child has a right to say, I need this and I want this. And if the family or the person doesn't give it to me, I'll call law in. And that's my major point, my friends, that there's been a huge paradigm shift, I think, over the last 30 or 40 years, especially beginning 1991, U.S. Covenant on what was then called Social, Political, Economic Rights. The 91 U.N. Covenant called it Social, Political, Economic Rights, essentially saying that, look, if one person does not get what's due to him or her, it must be provided by the state and the society. Like I said, it's not just in our field, but all fields. What I want to examine today and put before you, friends, is, and I'm hoping with Dr. Bhatia's, Dr. Shruti's help, I will someday be able to turn this to a piece that actually can be published for later thought. Like that old cliche, can this challenge be turned into an opportunity? And I do believe it can and it should. Let's examine for a minute before that, before getting into the issue of humanism and human rights framework in mental health practice, what are the major trends in the last few decades, at least in the 21st century? Leave alone epidemic for a minute. Increasing awareness and information and access to information about every aspect. We lament that our patients come to us with self-made diagnosis based on the internet, but please realize this happens in every field. The consumer is so empowered and well-informed. Decreasing social and family support systems, widening gap between the socioeconomic classes, emphasis on rights-based approach, we have said enough, and the centrality of that is the individual autonomy. That was essentially, don't forget, it was essentially North European Anglo-Saxon Protestant idea. Individualism is not even a totally Christian idea. Irish Catholicism would believe much more in collectivism than North European, Anglo-Saxon, Western Protestantism. As the political and economic might grew, that is the idea that has taken over the world in the 21st century. Individual autonomy, full stop. Nothing else matters. Widening gap between access to legal rights. What's the other major trend in the society, at least India and South Asia, for medical practice and towards doctors. Changing trend from complete and absolute respect and faith to lesser respect, to indifference, to now antagonism and anger. Our consumers and families are angry with us. Spread of private and corporate sector, as return assertion by doctors, there is huge variation in the attitude towards doctors. What's also happening, please realize, is judicial orders and interventions in case of medical negligence and increasing influence of the pharma industry. It's they who control the health care practice, let's face it. What are the major trends we see? And we wrote about this once based on a North Zone conference conclave. What are the major trends in society towards psychiatric practice? Increasing awareness, decreasing stigma, enhanced expectations, diversification of patients and clients, the nature of mental health problems. Mental illness, please remember, 1995 was the first time mental illness related disability got included as a disability. And we were all thrilled. When you look back in hindsight, I'm not too sure it was such a great idea, but it remains there. Celebrity endorsement in mental health. Of course, mental health now post-pandemic is becoming much more center stage. And so, if you talk about mental health practice, as in all healthcare practice, or indeed all helping professions, I think, but we want to talk about mental health practice, from being charity or sympathy-based, with very often the caring attitudes that people like Dr. Ayaja and others had, which was based on humanism, it has now turned to rights-based. Balance has shifted. This is what I want to make again and again. It's not as if our senior colleagues were not sensitive or not humane. So if you really ask the question, was our profession, were our seniors not caring enough for the society to have to enact laws so that you care? And the other point that I want to make to you, friends, is this. In my medical school days, and I think up until recently, there was always the idea that you were taught on a spectrum, moral values and morality is individual based, ethics, which is group based, consensus, better if you do it. If you don't do it, you might get a spanking, but you can't be punished for it. Third, law, that's enforceable. You can be punished if you don't follow it. Now, my major point, friends, is this. What's happened? Wait a minute, I'm going to go back to. I believe what has happened in psychiatric mental health practice, in medical practice, and in a whole lot of other helping professions is that the paradigm is shifting towards the right. Please try and recall those of us who have been in the field for 15 or 20 years. Those which were ethical codes of conduct are now part of the law. So earlier, up until the 90s, even up to the early part of this century, if you didn't do it, you could at best DPS or Delhi Medical Council or IMA or Medical Council will say, look, doctor, you better do it this way. Now it's part of the law. Do's and don'ts. So virtually there is very little. I really wonder, and I'm throwing this open more as a stimulating, provocative point. If you retain the idea of moral values as what it was, and if you see increasingly codified law, I don't think there is much that remains in the ethical code. Because whatever that was in ethics has now become part of the law. And that's what the problem is for us, at least providers. The landmark issue there, as most of you will remember, was the UNCRPD. That was a huge paradigm shift adopted by the UN General Assembly in 6-7, signed by the Government of India in 2007, ratified by Indian Parliament in 2008. And if some of our youngsters don't realize, please understand. Not only of the state, that is the central government or each state and each state agency, it's the duty of every citizen of this country to see that every provision in the UNCRPD is implemented, and if it's not implemented, you are responsible. So allow me to give a brief example. When your press wala in the apartment or in your bungalow gets the clothes delivered through a child, that's child labor violation. Okay. If there is any person in your vicinity, in your employment, in your hospital, with mental illness related disability who is not getting his right, legally you are bound to be able to provide it. So please don't labor under the wrong impression it's only for the government to do. It's the duty of every citizen of the country, because the parliament has ratified UNCRPD. And the entire thing there is, if you realize, I've said this already, that is the crucial part. Now, again, in reference to all the senior colleagues, Dr. Raheja merely as one of the hallmarks of persons that we remember, but many others that I've listed. Did these clinical colleagues or clinical teams did not see their patients as person? For their own time and in their own context, they did. And some of us who have lived long enough have witnessed that. The society and the law, international human thought, global human thought, by now does not accept that. It's not enough that I am your client and it's left to you to decide that you will treat me as a person out of your good faith or humanism. Because you are humane enough, you're willing to treat me as a person. Law says that's not enough. There will be somebody who will monitor. Somebody who will monitor that you better treat me as your client with the full rights of a personhood, and if you don't do that, you can be punished. There will be monitoring agencies. So it's no longer left to the feeling of humanism that our colleagues like Dr. Raheja practice very well and successfully. That's the important point. I have already said this and I won't spend time on that. I hope you also realize that, like I said, it was the Helsinki Declaration of 64 and that led to the 1991 US Covenant that ultimately came to be recognized as human rights. It's a different debate altogether. If you have ever wondered, any one of you, how and why do we talk about human rights? I mean, when we were in school, we are told constitutionally guaranteed fundamental rights. When did the term shift to human rights? Is it because there were parallel movements for animal rights? What is this whole funda about? Why human rights? Well, that's a different debate altogether. But in our context, what mattered, as Dr. Harshvardhan said, I'm moving in the wrong direction. The crucial part after UNCRPD was this. That we're all familiar with this, but I think it needs to be said again and again, that is this act that has brought about this codified change to human rights, and there is no escaping that, like UNCRPD, now much more. I just want to briefly mention that why I chose to talk about this also, and why I do when I look back, is that With fullest humility, I'm one of the few persons who has perhaps in the public sector in key positions worked through all the three acts. In the 1980s with the Indian Lunacy Act at demands, 87 Act for a long time at IBAS, and now for last few years with the MHA 2017. And so for good or bad, I've had that advantage of looking at the implementation of all three. We've spoken about this enough. But let's not forget, again, I'm trying to link the two aspects. If you remember your textbooks, or your classes, the first of the three or four revolutions in psychiatry, if you consider neuroimaging as the fourth, the first revolution was basically humanism. When Philip Pinel unshackled those inmates in the asylums, Sapetre, it was essentially humanism. So it's not really that new. What's different, and I really wish, I haven't understood why there was nobody to advise our friend Salman Khan, when he names his organization Being Human. For me, and I want to put it to you, not just linguistically, in conceptual terms, being human and being humane are very different issues. Like I put down here, being human is a claim. I'm a human being, you better treat me with respect. Being humane is an obligation to the other person and to everybody else. And please recognize this part. So we as service providers we need to remember this. The humanism is not only about I assert that I am a human being, better deal with me properly. But your obligation and my obligation to deal with every client and the family member and the carer, that's being humane. And obviously, somewhere along the line, the society or the larger human thought did not think it was happening, especially with the disabled persons. Much as we may not like it, and with the greatest respect for senior colleagues like Dr. Aheja and hundreds, if not thousands of others, the fact is that the human thought has moved towards the need for enforcing it. You will come across a professional term, humanitarians. That's a totally different issue. In international terms, those who work in humanitarian crisis situation. Now come to the crucial part. What are the merits and demerits of this new human rights framework, at least for our field of mental health? To me, it would seem more advocacy is possible. And so it should lead to more funds and resources and more support from the state. It should ensure access to service for many people, if not most people. And most importantly, it should control at least the grossly unethical practices that we all know about. What are the demerits? It's obviously, in addition to everything else that we have listed earlier, this act and these provisions only add to, as we keep discussing, ADIVAS and otherwise, an atmosphere of antagonism between the service provider and the client. Defensive practice that we all know about doesn't even need to be said more. Increasing cost of services. And most importantly, the difficult cases are not going to be dealt with. As I talk about, and if you have realized, Dr. Rajas, have I really had respect for when I got to know in the 80s, even in Bangalore, and after I moved to Delhi, I got to know in the 90s, that he was one of the first few, if not the only person, to offer rescue services. Now, I'll be honest, it seemed illegal, it seemed unethical. But then when I sat and realized, he being a friend and in talks with him and otherwise, his families who would visit AIIMS OPD and say, we had taken help from Dr. Aheja, his team came and rescued. If I might put it crudely, one ambulance, char mushrande, jaake bande ko ghar se sedate karke, nursing home mein admit karna. Now, for all the nonsense across sectors that you're all familiar with, fortunately, I haven't suffered from that, respecting private sector as much as I respect what my colleagues and I do. One major lesson was, as I shifted from AIIMS Srivas, that he was meeting a need. He was meeting a need that nobody else was willing to or able to meet with. Those persons with severe mental disorders who had to be tied up at home, who had to be left locked in a room, and the family would be helpless. Dr. Aheja Saab, with his pragmatism and innovation that he spoke about, and the fearlessness that I didn't mention, had this innovation to say, I will go rescue that person. And I'm going to come back to that in the context of what we are now trying to do at IBAS as my felt responsibility on behalf of the state. But I do really think that what the new act is going to do is, most of us would be happy to deal with depression, anxiety, stress disorder, at best schizophrenia and mania, who are willing to agree for treatment, capacity intact. Capacity impaired, not willing for admission, involuntary hospitalization, go home or remain on the street. Why would you or I in our own setting risk ourselves or our organization? The defensive practice. The last part, that's what I was talking about. From honestly, and one at one point of time, somewhere in the first decade of this century, 2002, 2003, 2004, 2005, I remember, I don't remember the details, but I did actually invite Dr. Aheja Saab to share with us a mix of public sector and private sector colleagues in psychiatry and mental health about his rescue practice. And there was a lot to learn from all that I have said till now, how he was actually meeting a need and how he was still taking care of his self-defense. That pragmatism and a lot of other experiences after that have led my team and me to propose in 11, 12, nearly now 10 years ago, what we had only as a pilot, mobile mental health unit. That has an ambulance, that has a medical officer, counselor with a nurse to go and rescue not just the homebound but homeless mentally ill people, both. Now, the happy part, my friends, is that this is what it does, at least for the homeless people. And the homebound mentally people are not grossly different, let's face it. some of them neglected. We have had number of instances, a lot of colleagues who are here who have worked at IVAS for the last 20 years at one point of time, we have had people brought from family in similar condition. If you can do effective, legally permissible, ethically valid rescue service, this is the difference that you make to each one of them. And what I'm happy to share with you towards the end, my friends, is this. This epidemic has at least helped us achieve this. You will hopefully by early 22, ambulances procured, staff recruited, already being trained. You will have one MMHU in each of the districts in Delhi. Hopefully in 1 or 2 years, 2 MMHUs in each district. What will they do as of now? Rescue of homeless mentally ill persons, rescue of homebound mentally ill persons, emotional crisis, including suicide crisis, aftercare that you only hear about in Australia, England, UK, New Zealand. Right? You'll possibly have that. And I really do believe that large part of that has been possible because of inspiration from senior colleagues like Dr. Iyer sir. A whole lot of others. I mean, today we are talking about paying homage to one of these specific senior colleagues, and sure, Dr. Iyer sir, who actually was more than family. And I'm so glad the entire family is here. But that aside, that personal connection and bias aside, I really don't know of. I don't know of anybody in the country, and I've worked and looked at the mental health service in this country across. I don't know of anybody who had the guts in the 90s to provide and offer consistently rescue services. I'm going to end there, my friends, except for the last part. Oh, yeah. For why I'm trying to connect the two is, what is it that we should do, and especially the next two generations after us, from Deepak Gupta and Deepak Raida and Pankaj to the next two generations. I think we need to accept the reality of the fact that your being humane is not going to be enough, as I've said enough. There is a human rights framework that is going to watch over you. You better build partnerships with those who seem to be your antagonists or worse. Maximize the opportunity, it's been said enough, especially the post-pandemic scenario. And I put it to you, ladies and gentlemen, retain humanism with the human rights framework. That's not impossible. If we have time, maybe tomorrow we'll talk about it. But that's my major message. This is a Macabre slide for those of you who might quickly be able to appreciate it. When you carry the idea of human rights too far, this is what the representation will be like. You don't hang a disabled person, but if you insist on doing so, and if you want to still protect rights, then you'll provide a noose for a person in wheelchair. And in the end, friends, again, with Dr. Iyer Saab, many other colleagues who we can think of, and I suppose a whole lot of us in psychiatry, mental health, or in any helping profession, as I see, the broad range of helping professions, that's the theme song. Hey, that sir, none of you can make out. Can you? Can you? Can't hear.
तू निसार किसी का दर्द मिल सके तो ले उधार किसी के वास्ते हो तेरे दिल में प्यार जीना इसी का नाम है.
I Thank you. I do want to one more time say that, like many others, definitely a few notable colleagues, Dr. Iyer Saab, I think, lived his life with this theme song in his heart. Thank you very much.
Can't hear me? You can't hear me? नहीं सुना तो फिर से सुना दूं. मैं कह रही थी दीपक रहेजा एंड हिज टीम हैव सेलेक्टेड द राइट पर्सन चूजन डॉक्टर रहेजा'स अवार्ड. जूनियर रहेजा इज ऑल्सो डूइंग द सेम थिंग एंड ही हैज रियली डन अ रियल जस्टिस टू हिज contributing to his Shraddhanjali to Dr. Raheja. I cannot have words, I'm not very good in English or Hindi, to appreciate somebody's personality. But Dr. Raheja was a very warm person, real human, and really worked for the patient. Like he said, Dr. Vidya Sagar, we all know from Rohtak, was a Vidya Sagar of Delhi. So there is no words to describe that. Theek hai? Dr. Vadhavan, kuch bol do.
I think it was very difficult task to give a Shraddhanjali to person like Dr. S.C. Raheja, who has been pioneer in Delhi private psychiatry, indoor services, and rehabilitation services. And to justify, somebody who could justify, I think Dr. Nimesh Desai was the one who could justify. Dr. Raheja, apart from a great friend, a great professional, he was very friendly to all of us. I had the great opportunity to be near his setup in Sir Gangaram Hospital. Sometime he will just walk in, he will say, let us have, let us share meal together, let us have tea together. So he was very friendly and he will always encouraging. And he always used to motivate not only his colleagues, but, one thing very great, which probably we need to put in words, that he, both his sons, he encouraged them to be psychiatrist. And whenever Dr. Raheja used to talk to me, sometimes he used to talk that it's very, difficult to practice psychiatry sometimes. You have human rights, you have to fight for the rights of the individuals, you have to write for the patients, for the right of the psychiatrist. And still he encouraged Deepak and Nikhil to be, I think they are great psychiatrists, and Deepak is doing very well in the de-addiction services, and Nikhil also, he's holding the fort, which is, Dr. S.C. Raheja had started. I think it's a great service that to encourage your future generations to follow that path. I think to all this, and I congratulate actually the selection committee to propose Dr. Nimesh Desai for this award, who all the time, I think Dr. Desai is the one whose eyes are always open for psychiatrists. He's always in either in conferences, discussing, teaching, I think doing walking. I think psychiatry is passion. So I congratulate Dr. Nimesh Desai for giving a very, very befitting oration and tribute to Dr. S.C. Raheja. Thank you very much.
Amongst many other things, can I just say one thing? The only person I know in this country, at least in psychiatry, if not all of medicine, who would at the drop of a hat, 1 or 2 days notice, invite the delegates of a conference in Delhi on his personal expense to a meal. With 100 or 150 or 200 people, IASP, IPS, North Zone, it has happened more than once or twice in my knowledge. The large-heartedness was unbelievable. And so, achha, conference kar rahe ho? Achha, humare ghar ke bichhe ground mein wahan le aao, dinner wahan karenge, conference ka. Babi ji, please. Aana padega aapko. नहीं ऐसे नहीं चलेगा भाभी जी प्लीज मैं अभी तो बहुत सारी बातें नहीं कर रहा हूं मक्के की रोटी और सरसों का साग आपके हाथ का खाना सबको खिलाए एक बार निखिल प्लीज भाभी जी ऐसे कैसे दीपक कम
आई वुड लाइक थैंक यू निमेश सर फॉर सच एलोक्वेंट टॉक एंड सच एलोक्वेंट फ्रॉम हार्ट मैं श्रीमती महेश रेजा जी से गुजारिश करूंगा
स्टेज पर आए, डॉक्टर दीपक रहेजा स्टेज पर आए, डॉक्टर निखिल रहेजा स्टेज पर आए, डॉक्टर प्रीति स्टेज पर आए, और मैं पूरी रहेजा फैमिली को बोलूंगा स्टेज पर आए प्लीज. इट इज ए मोमेंट फॉर ऑनर फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस. प्लीज मैम आइए, मैम रहेजा मैम आइए प्लीज. प्लीज ऑल ऑफ यू. आगे आगे सारे प्लीज प्लीज शॉल लाएं प्लीज. मैम आइए आओ बेटा. मैं नीना मैम से गुजारिश करूंगा कि श्रीमती महेश प्रसाद जी को शॉल उड़ाकर सम्मानित करें. नीना मैम आप प्लीज मैम को शॉल उड़ाएं. मैम को थैंक यू मैम. बिग क्लैप्स. अब मैम वृंदावन सर को गुजारिश करूंगा सर निमेश सर को शॉल उड़ाएं. एक मिनट मैम देते हैं पहले शॉल सर को निमेश सर को शॉल. वृंदावन सर शॉल उड़ाएं प्लीज. अब मैं श्रीमती महेश रेजा जी से गुजारिश करूंगा कि सर को ट्रॉफी देके सम्मानित करें. ओरेशन वर्ड की सर सेंटर में आए प्लीज. मैम सेंटर में आए. हाँ आए रेजा परिवार पूरा प्लीज सेंटर में आए और सम्मानित करें सर को. अब मैं गुजारिश करूँ सब ताली बजा के सर का जोरदार तालियों से धन्यवाद. दीपक रेजा सर वृंदावन सर को शॉल उड़ाएं प्लीज. डॉक्टर दीपक गुप्ता सर प्लीज स्टेज पे आए एक बार. डॉक्टर दीपक गुप्ता सर आप ट्रॉफी दें डॉक्टर वृंदावन सर को. दीपक गुप्ता सर सर को मेमेंटो दें. नहीं 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 ये वृंदावन सर का है. अरे हो गया अच्छा ठीक है. थैंक यू सर. थैंक यू ऑल ऑफ यू. एक फोटो प्लीज एक हो जाए के साथ. थैंक यू आप सबका बहुत धन्यवाद. थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर ऑल ऑफ यू. प्लीज टेक योर सीट. नाउ आई डोंट वांट टू डिले दिस लवली नाइट. आई थैंक यू ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर बीइंग हियर ऑन दिस चिली नाइट एंड आई रिक्वेस्ट ऑल ऑफ यू प्लीज जॉइन अस फॉर डिनर. Thank you very much. Good night. And hope to see you tomorrow, 10 a.m. sharp.
Please enjoy the dinner. And we hope to have a wonderful conference deliberation tomorrow starting 10 a.m. Thank you very much. Enjoy the dinner. Please be here for the dinner. Thank you.
से काटने लगा
Mera